Unfortunately, we had an historic event occur early in the week. Our national debt, which went over $15 trillion, went over our GDP. It's the first time in the history of our whole country. But it's not only our country that's facing this. The world has a GDP of $195 trillion. And guess what? Their deficit in this year is the same amount. So this is absolutely unsustainable, and we have to recognize this. It's been going on for a long time. I had talked about this for many years and anticipated that we would end up with a worldwide crisis like this. But I got energized, you know, in the early 1970s, realizing that our change in monetary policy would lead to this. And this is the reason that I talk a whole lot about reining in, auditing, and eventually getting rid of the Federal Reserve. Yeah! Reserve system comes into being and promises to be the lender of last resort. They usually are the last resort, and it'll be the last thing we do. But the real evil here, and in 1971, we severed the last link of our dollar to gold, which ushered in this new age that we've had since 1971, and that meant that the politicians could spend money without any responsibility. They could tax, but there wouldn't be enough. They could borrow, but that would never be enough. Then they resorted to inflation. Now, the collapse didn't come in the 1970s, although it was a rocky period of time, but it ushered in this age where there's endless spending. Conservatives and liberals said deficits don't matter. Deficits do matter. They matter to you as an individual. They matter to us as a country. They matter to the whole world. But we ushered in this age where we depended on the Fed just to create the money when we had to pay the bills. Now, when the country is very wealthy, they can do that for a while. But then eventually they have to borrow a lot more money and live beyond our means. During the Great Depression, we were a creditor nation. Now, since the 1970s, we've been a great debtor nation. We are the biggest debtor nation in the history of the world. We owe over $3 trillion to foreigners. And they think we're going to bail out everybody else. It makes absolutely no sense. It's the Federal Reserve that, by interfering in the monetary system, monkeying around with interest rates, they create the bubbles. And for a while, they can create one bubble and patch it up again, but eventually the big bubble bursts. And this is what we're witnessing right now. We're witnessing the end of an economic era. This is a tremendous opportunity for us who believe in liberty to get our message out. It is well known by all those who are pretending to patch this network and financial system together again. They know what we know. They know it's unsustainable. It's not a viable system. And they are making plans. They are making plans, and they are not too secretive about it. They're talking about a worldwide fiat currency. Instead of the dollar standard, they want to use the United Nations and the IMF and whatever. But you know, we ought to stay old-fashioned. We ought to believe in national sovereignty and that we deal with our own problems. The whole idea about depending on sovereignty, of course, the most sovereign part of government should be us over sovereignty of our own lives. That's where the thing should originate. Then it should be with our families and friends, our neighbors, our communities, and our local governments. Obviously, we've had too much drift toward Washington. Our federal government is way too big. Our Constitution, the people have failed the Constitution in a sense. The Constitution was written not to restrain you in any way, but to restrain the federal government. Yeah. Yeah. big concern is going even one step further with one world government. Just take a look at what's happened in our foreign policy. Do we go to war with a declaration of war anymore? No. Our presidents go to NATO and the United States, and they take our money and our kids and fight these endless wars that make no sense, that contribute significantly to our bankruptcy. It's time to end those wars and bring our troops home. Spending $10 billion a month fighting these wars. We've been in Afghanistan 10 years. There's a claim that we're coming home from Iraq. We're not coming home. They're just taking some troops out and hiring contractors who are going to get paid twice as much as the military was paid. But we have bases in 130-some countries, 900 bases. We have these drone stations throughout the world, and we just bomb at will. And then our people wonder, why do they get annoyed with us? Every once in a while we miss our target and we have, oh, that's collateral damage, don't worry about it. But this type of a foreign policy where we think we have to be everything to everybody, tell everybody else what to do, decide everybody else's border, get into nation building, spread our goodness and our great democracy, people don't like that. And it's bankrupting us. Is it time to change our foreign policy? It amazes me how long the system lasts. There's a lot of momentum to a free society. The wealth is gone. Our liberties are being undermined, and it is coming to an end, but I'm amazed it's lasted this long. But take for example, the ineptness of what they did when we invaded Iraq. They say, well, we have to influence the dissidents. There's some people over there that might not like us being in our country, so we need to go over there with a lot of cash, because American cash still had some value. They packed up carloads of this, plane loads of cash, to the tune of $60 billion. And guess what? They can't even account for it. It is utterly amazing that the system tolerates this, and that we who run a program like that are going to bail out the world. Our national debt now is equal, to our GDP, and as well as in the world. So this cannot be sustainable. We have to decide what we want. This gives us an opportunity to decide what the role of government ought to be. The founders made that decision. They said the role of government ought to be very limited. What we should do is emphasize personal liberty. Leave the responsibility on the individual to take care of his or her own life. Principles in a free society. One is that you and I, nor our government, shall be allowed to use force to tell other people how to run their life. It's not much more complicated than that. One of the reasons why there's a lot of resistance to this, that if we release this control over people and telling what they can eat, drink, and smoke, and how they run their habits and what they do, they say, well, they might do something that is unappealing to others, and that we have to protect them from themselves. But you know what? Once government embarks on protecting us from ourselves, there's very little liberty left. That means that when the individual acts in a certain way, whether it's religious values, intellectual values, or personal habits, that those of us who disagree have to be tolerant of it. Well, what happens, though, is that individuals who resent this and want to tell everybody else what to do, they are intolerant to what other people think and do, because they think that if you legalize something, if they legalize your choice to run your own life, that means we endorse what you do. But that isn't the way it is. You don't have to, and we don't endorse what people do in religious values at all. But we want it to be legal intellectually. We want people to be allowed to read and study what they want. We have to combat bad ideas with good ideas. But when it comes to the government telling us what we do with our own bodies, all of a sudden, the government, a bunch of do-gooders in Washington, want to tell us exactly what we should do. Now, because of that attitude, it has been something terrible to our society here at home. Of course, we're strongly opposed to all these wars overseas and the mentality that goes with the wars, because along with the wars overseas comes with this fear-mongering that, and under times of war, we have to really bear down on the civil liberties here at home, so we have to pass things like the Patriot Act. We don't need the Patriot Act. What we need to do is repeal the Patriot Act. That's what we need. But there's another war that goes on here on our personal liberty. It has something to do with personal habits. And many times these personal habits aren't all that wonderful. But the war on drugs for the past 40 years has consumed over $1 trillion. It has accomplished nothing as far as containing the unwise use of drugs. And what it has done is undermine our liberties. I believe it's time not only to stop the wars overseas, but stop the wars on drugs here at home. Attempt to legislate morality. We, as a country that has 1%, 5% of the whole population, we have 1% of our people are in prison. We have more prisoners than anybody else. We have 50,000 SWAT type of no-knock break-ins in our country every year. And these are illegal because they don't have the proper authority. They do not have true search warrants when they come in and they break in. The other day there was a case where there was a veteran, a Marine, that he was in his house with his family. He heard some banging and breaking in his front door. He hid his wife and daughter in a cupboard. He went out, he grabbed his gun and walked out there. And as he approached the door, he had, I think there were 72 shots fired by those SWAT teams. 28 of them went into his body. He never pulled, he never took his safety off his gun, never shot one bullet. And now, what is going on here? We have so little respect for the rule of law, whether it's domestically or internationally. We have become known as a country that endorses torture, that we do not pay much attention to habeas corpus. We have secret prisons around the world. And if you suggest, well, that's not good and that's not legal, they say, well, they're very bad people. But we don't know. They're all suspect. Not only have we done this around the world by lobbing cruise missiles and drone missiles, we have now had an announced policy in this country by the current president that this is legitimate policy to assassinate American citizens. No charges made, no trial. The president himself becomes the prosecutor, he becomes the judge, the jury, and the executioner. Because there are, I'm sure there are bad people. This Alaki obviously was fomenting crimes and violence, although he was never charged with a crime. But he was deemed a very dangerous person, so he was targeted and he was killed. He was the first American that openly was targeted by our government and was assassinated, along with a bystander, another American citizen, was killed. But that wasn't enough. Our government said no. They thought that his son was also much involved, so therefore, a week or so later, they sent another cruise missile drone attack. And they, bombed and killed his son, Alaki's son. But then when they found out, they don't talk about this case, because when they found out about it, The kid was 16 years old, and he was in the backyard barbecuing with a friend of his. But he was never charged. But people say, well, they're still just a couple. Still, don't worry about it. These are bad people. But what we must worry about is the rule of law, because the rule of law protects us and more, and that has to be protected. Economy needs a lot of adjustment. We've talked a lot about monetary policy, and we got into this trouble because of the financial bubbles created by our Federal Reserve System. I do not believe we can get out of this mess without understanding how the business cycle works. The business cycle works merely by the federal government coming in through the combination of congressional law and the Federal Reserve. They create excessive money, drive interest rates down. The message we get from low interest rates is that there's a lot of savings, and then businessmen overinvest, build too many houses, prices go up too high in certain areas, bubbles form. So the reason we're in a deep recession, depression at the moment is because we had a huge financial bubble that was patched together over these last 40 years, and it finally met the point of no return. Now, what have been the tools when there's an attempt of the market to correct things? The government has always resorted to spending more money and printing more money. And it tended to help over these years, but now it doesn't help anymore. How can you lower interest rates? They're below zero right now. They can't get much lower than that. How can they increase spending when there is no money? And our deficit this year is $1.5 trillion. That cannot solve the problem. When there are mistakes, when there's overinvestment, when prices go up too high, this has to be liquidated. We would have done much better if in 2008 the government would have just stepped back, and would not have bailed out the rich bankers and the corporations. Yeah. Would have been better. There would be a great danger, and there was fear built up. They said if we don't bail out the system, there would be a depression. Well, guess where the depression would have been? It would have been on those who were receiving our money. Instead, the depression was delivered to the people, the middle class. They lost their jobs and they lost their houses, and we, the taxpayer, absorbed the debt. The bad debt was transferred from the illiquid operations of the banks and the mortgage companies and delivered to the Treasury as well as the Federal Reserve. So it was just a transfer. This is just prolonging the agony. This is what Japan has done for 20 years. This is what we did in the Depression. The main reason that they keep doing this is because the ideas that have infiltrated Washington for many decades have been driven by Keynesian economics. We have to repeal Keynesian economics and introduce free market. Those of us who have advocated this position say, well, they don't understand, because you can't have inflation. If you increase the money supply in a weak economy, that won't cause inflation. Well, the only thing they forget about is that you can have stagflation and you can have inflationary depressions, because once you print a lot of money, you devalue the currency. And that is what we're doing. You can't get out of this trouble by just printing the money and trying to maintain a system that is not viable. What has happened to us is we've lost our confidence that a free society actually works, that free market works, that we have lost the confidence that property is supposed to be owned by the people and not controlled by the government. Property really isn't our own. We pay huge taxes, and we have to ask a lot of permission before we can use our land, and sometimes we can't use it because we can't get around all the regulations. But if this isn't a partisan issue, you know, when we got into some trouble 10 years ago approximately when Enron failed and Republicans were in charge, they said, well, there weren't enough regulations. So what they did was they passed Sarbanes-Oxley. It is estimated now, and by the way, there were a total of three of us that voted against that. That's how uniform the whole system was, more regulations as a solution. But it is estimated now that Sarbanes-Oxley has cost this economy $1 trillion in these past 10 years. It is also estimated that Dodd-Frank, the new regulatory bill that's been there a year, it has cost or will cost $1 trillion as well. And then there's this other little item thrown out at us to further undermine our liberties and our freedom of choice is the Obama medical care program. That's another. So whether it's medical care or education or housing, when governments get involved, they print the money, they create inflation in those areas. When you increase the money supply, all prices and all labor prices do not go up evenly. They go up unevenly. So what have we done for education and housing and et cetera? We want, those who are motivated, many with good intentions, and they say, well, we want to help the people who can't afford it and make sure they get an education. So what have we done? We illegally, in the federal government, because there's no authority in the federal government to be involved in education, they take over education and create a department of, like a Department of Education, which we should abolish. System. Did the quality of education go up? No. Did the price of education go up? Skyrocketing. So what happens? We have a lot more graduates graduating with poor education, not well trained, and no jobs. And now, students getting out of college right now owe more money than all our credit cards. That's how big it is. So the system fails. This whole program of giving everybody a house, that failed. They're ended up losing their houses. And in medicine, it's the same thing. They pump a lot of money into medicine. They take away our right of freedom of choice. And we end up with high cost of medicine, the quality of medicine going down. But there's a lot of special interests that control these programs. For instance, in medicine, whether the Republicans are passing a bill or the Democrats are passing a bill, guess who line up as the lobbyists? Drug companies and insurance companies, and they're the ones who help write these bills. And this is the reason your cost of medicine continues to go up. But what else do they do? What else does the drug company do to interfere with your freedom of choice? Because right now, your freedom of choice of looking at alternative medical programs and medical care and nutritional product is always being curtailed because of the drug companies. We should make sure that everybody has free choices in all that they do and make sure that you have a freedom of choice in your medical products as well. The war on drugs and all the tragedy comes from that. The addiction rate from conventional medicine and legalized medication is much, much greater problem than it is on the illegal drugs. But one of the silliest things that we have done is we've taken this war on marijuana and said, well, there is another plant that sort of looks like marijuana, although you can't smoke it and you can't use it for much other than industrial products. We have to make it illegal as well. So what have they done? They've decided that nobody in this country can raise hemp.
That's right.
You know, it's an industrial product. It can create thousands and thousands of jobs. In the 19th century, there were thousands of farms that raised this. In times of war, we've encouraged people to raise it because of the alternative things that they can do. So what do? There are a lot of raisins in Canada. They make products, and they sell us the products from Canada. But all we have to do is not, we don't have to understand each little issue. All we have to do is legalize freedom. And these are what these problems are. But It's been a long time since we've had a full understanding and enthusiasm for liberty. But the one thing that I have noticed, especially coming and talking with young people, this is where I get my encouragement. The spirit of liberty is alive and well with many, many young people and a large number of remnant. The people in the remnant have been around for a good many years and haven't had a voice whatsoever. So I believe you cannot stop an idea whose time has come. And the idea of liberty, the time has returned to us. Approximately 100 years ago when freedom was chopped up into pieces. Freedom is the freedom to run your life and also to keep the fruits of your labor, which means we shouldn't have an income tax either. One group decided they'd defend economic liberty, and that was good. Then another one said, well, no, we're going to not have economic liberty, but we want to protect personal choices and personal lifestyles. But why is it that we have to have two parts of freedom? Why shouldn't freedom be one thing? Our right, our natural right to our life, a natural right to our liberties. And that means that we have control of our lives. We're in charge of our lives, not the government. So, the income tax makes the assumption that everything you earn belongs to the government. And then on their permission, the permission of the government, you're allowed to keep a certain percentage of your income under certain conditions. So that is the destruction of liberty. We did at one time have the greatest understanding and the greatest prosperity of any nation on earth. But now we aren't in that category. Another issue that I think demonstrates the importance of understanding the right to your life and the ownership of your own life is the principle of the military draft. I know we don't have a draft now, but we still have registration just in case. But we've had a draft. I happen to have been drafted back in the 1960s. But when the government has you have all 18-year-olds still sign up, it's a messy sense. We own you. We can take you. We can use you. If we need to fight a war, and it's a legitimate war, we've been attacked, it should be done deliberately through the people and their members of Congress voting for it, and not by one person in Washington, to go to war or under the UN or the IMF, and there should never be a draft, but we should all be willing to defend our country. Freedom has not been around a terribly long time. If you look at all of history, and if you look at the current history around the world today, most of it is tyranny, tyrants, people wanting to run other people's lives. And there are many in Washington that have been running our foreign policy in both parties for a good many years now. They say that America is an exceptional nation. In a way, and our history could show that maybe we have some exceptional traits. But what they mean by exceptionalism and that we have this moral obligation to spread our values mean that we do this by force, that we go over and tell other people how they have to live.
No way.
But guess what? Special interests get control of that attitude, and lo and behold, they help some countries that are on their way to democracy. They hurt those countries, and then they prop up many dictators. If you look at our history over the past 20 years, so many of the bad guys have both been our friends and our enemy. They're our friends as long as they do our bidding. They're our enemies if they don't listen to us. You know, we've been offered two types of foreign policy, basically, over these many years. One says that we go to a country and we ask them to do something and to be on our side. And if they do it, we give them a lot of money. Then we go to somebody else and they say, no, we're not going to do it. We're our own country. So then we bomb them. I think there should be another option. The Constitution Revolution and our founders gave us another option. They said we should be friends with all who want to be friends, trade with all who would like to trade with us, and be in negotiating form and never be aggressors. But today, I thought there were those only two choices, and I offered the third. But unfortunately, we've ended up with a fourth one, which dramatizes how foolhardy our foreign policy is. And it has to do with Pakistan. Pakistan, you know, we are dropping a lot of dropping bombs, and killed literally thousands of people. Nobody knows the exact number, but literally a lot of people have been killed there. And there's collateral damage, but we don't count those individuals as people. But at the same time, we're dropping and antagonizing the people, and the people resent it and really despise us doing this. We're giving billions of dollars to the government of Pakistan. And there's a civil strife building there. And then lo and behold, now there's even talk about what else that we must do. Will we have to send our troops in there? And then we had a comment just the other day by the propped up leader that we have in Afghanistan, somebody that's been associated with his family, associated with drugs and corruption. The president is called by the name of Karzai. So Karzai said, well, in gratitude for what you have done for me, in case you go to war with Pakistan, we're going to side with Pakistan. So this whole thing of supporting individuals, we were on the side of bin Laden. We had been on the side of Saddam Hussein. Whose side are we on in Saudi Arabia? Oh, yeah, we're good friends with Saudi Arabia. But guess what? 15 out of the 19 individuals that came here on 9/11 came from Saudi Arabia. And also, they have a dictatorship. They follow Sharia law. They're not Democrats. And yet, we're their best friends, so to speak. I think the founders had it right. Be neutral. Mind our own business. Come home and be willing to trade and talk to people. You know, Ronald Reagan had one of the most fantastic statements when he wrote his memoirs. Because in the early 80s, I was in Congress and then back out and then went back in again. But in the early 80s, I was there when Reagan sent the troops, sent the Marines into Lebanon. And I can remember speaking out against this and worrying about what might happen. And when he sent the troops in, he was challenged about, well, are you going to really stay there and be determined? Or are you ever going to leave? He said, I will never leave with my tail between my legs. But the Marines got killed and the troops came out. Suicide terrorism stopped. As soon as the French and Israel and the United States left, there was no more suicide terrorism in that region. So when Reagan wrote his memoirs on this, he talked about the Marines, and I thought it was very significant. So he said that I know what I said. I said I wouldn't leave with my tail between my legs. He says, but the reason I did that, he says, I had not realized how irrational the politics of that region was. So he was admitting the truth. And he went on to say that he said if he had had a policy of neutrality and had followed that at that time, he says those Marines would still be alive today. Now, that is an astounding statement because it is so true, said by a person who made a mistake, admitted the mistake. Something similar to this happened with McNamara. Before he died, he wrote some memoirs. And they weren't exactly apologetic, but there was a lot of admission there that Vietnam was a total disaster. What a tragedy. 60,000 Americans killed, and he was really the orchestrator of that war. So when he was being interviewed about the book, one of the interviewers said, do you want to apologize for what you had done? And he says, what good would an apology be? He said, the only thing that is of any value is you recognize the mistakes and you change your policy, change your way. So what I would like to see happen, and I think it is happening because the country's coming our way and 65% of the people want to come out of Afghanistan. We have to admit the truth. We can't keep lying to ourselves. If we have a policy that is deeply flawed, we have to come clean and change it, whether it's monetary policy or foreign policy or Federal Reserve policy or spending policy. We have to admit the truth that we went the wrong direction, and we can change it. Think about the Vietnam War, because I was in the service. I never went to Vietnam, but the saying was when Kennedy was in office and then Johnson expanded the war, the comment was always, we have to stop it or there would be a domino effect. It would just go all communist throughout the region, and that was why we were supposed to be there. So what happened? We literally lost. We have to admit that. We lost and we left, and it was a tragedy. Loss of life and many dollars ushered in the inflation of the 1970s. But what did it usher in an age where the communists took over? Did the communists in China become more communistic, or did they move in the direction of becoming westernized where now there are bankers? What happened in Vietnam? They became more westernized when there was no use of force, no war, no invasion of armies. All of a sudden they looked and they decided they would go in a different direction. Now we trade with them, we travel back and forth with them. Their president comes here and visits. So there's pretty darn strong evidence that you can gain a lot more in peace than in war and accomplishment. One of the reasons I'm excited about the whole freedom movement is that my personal beliefs are very much in coincidence with our Constitution, the protection of liberty. But I have a personal reason why I want to live in a free society. I believe I could say that even if I were poor, and we would all be poor, I would still want to live in a free society. But we don't have to make that decision, because the freer a society, the more wealth is and the better distribution. There's not an equality of wealth. When you strive for equality of wealth, you can get it, and the wealth is very low. But if you strive for freedom, you will have the maximum wealth and the best distribution. So, but my personal belief is that our goals have to be more than just, our wealth. But I think freedom offers us an opportunity to be more creative, and it offers us a chance to exert our responsibility to strive for excellence and virtue in our personal lives. Now, governments right now make this attempt. They want us to be virtuous, and they want everything to be fair and equal. But every time the government does that, they have to do it at the expense of liberty. So therefore, the free society is the only one that can come up with a prosperous society, and one that offers us the maximum opportunity to maximize our own abilities. And I'm concerned because though there's lots of reason to be optimistic about our movement and our gaining of attention, but also when you see what's happening on the streets around the world and in this country as well, I think it's all healthy when they're talking about there are problems out there and the government has messed up and we need to look at the Federal Reserve, we need to look at these wars. This is all very healthy. But then there's another element that would like to that would like to take on the opportunity and say, no, it's because there's a profit system and people make profits. We have to distinguish the difference between people making honest profits versus those who are ripping us off and using the government to make profits and getting their bailout.
Thank you.
But the opportunity presents ourselves to ourselves now, and something will come of it. There will not be the maintaining of the status quo. The last 40 years of the status quo of spending more and printing more and that whole process, that has ended. I don't think for a minute that hasn't ended. A lot of people haven't awakened to this. They're getting more concerned. But the big question is, what are we going to replace it with? We don't have to invent it. This country knew something about it. We once understood what property rights were, contracts rights, individual liberty, and sound money, a sensible foreign policy. So we don't have to come along and invent something brand new. All we need to do is send people to Washington who understand and are determined to follow the rule of law and respect our Constitution. Yeah. There's every reason to be optimistic that if we do our job well, we can win this battle. You know, Samuel Johnson said that it isn't a numbers game. A lot of people worry, well, 51% aren't with us. Samuel Adams said, he said, you know what we need? He says, we need an irate, tireless minority willing to stand up and spread the brush fires of freedom in the minds and hearts of the American people and the people. And I believe that is what is happening. Our time has arrived. We must win this, because if we do not, and if we succumb to more government, that means less liberty and not the kind of world we want to live in. Let's be optimistic and fight for our freedoms and our Constitution. Thank you very much.